140 on my watch. So we're starting lecture 4. Only 2 lectures to go today. Next Monday, you have a free day due to our holidays. And then today, in 2 weeks, we have our final lecture. And there will be a guest speaker who did some work in the trenches investigating incidents. But today, yes, when it happens, most of the time, it's not. It happens, but most of the time it's shit that happens. And it's the job of an incident response team to solve the problem that occurred as soon and efficient as possible. And this lecture will also be a starter for the assignment number 3 that you will brief about at the end of the lecture. Okay. The menu. I'll start with a small, short recapitulation of some fundamentals on incident response. Then we dive deep into incident response in practice. What to do when it happens. And that's all necessary to accomplish assignment number 3. I will give you the brief and I will show you at the end of the lecture the homework. Okay. Some fundamentals we already talked about, so it's a quick refresher. You know, when we talk about incidents, and especially incidents in the context of security, we always have our assets as an organization, and every asset has one or more vulnerabilities. Possibilities, holes that threat agents can use to perform an attack. If you have an asset with a vulnerability, then you have a certain threat, namely the possibility that some attacker might use the vulnerability to get hold of your asset or assets. A threat is not a real incident yet. It's only a possible occurrence that can happen. And if a threat becomes manifest, is getting real, so somebody is attacking you, then we call it an event, and this event is most of the times a security event, and that have such an event has 2 potential consequences. No consequences at all, well, okay. Name is, does it have consequences? Then we don't have an event. No, then we have an incident. And then we have to decide as incident response team, how are we going to tackle this security event being a specific type or category of incident. We know if a threat gets manifest becoming an event with possible consequences, then the consequences for our assets and therefore for our organization could be either loss of people or loss of property or loss of secret proprietary information or even loss of our reputation as an organization, as a business. It could be one type of loss, it could be several types of loss. And when we talk about security, namely information security, then we have to look into what kind of loss of information there might be. Is the confidentiality or the integrity or the availability of our information in danger? So we have to distinguish between an event. An event is simply an action or an activity taking place, nothing bad at all. But when an event grows into something that might harm our assets, might cause loss, then we call it an incident. Because that is something that we didn't expect, or at least we didn't want to happen. And we know that if we have an event that has become an incident, we know there are four categories that we can use to label or pinpoint the type of security incident. It's either unauthorized usage, get your fingers off our assets. It's a denial of service, you can't get hold of your data, or you can't use the services your organization is offering. Malicious code, some mean person injected some dangerous pieces of software into your IT infrastructure, and it could also be a category of inappropriate usage. You use the asset not as it's meant to be. Okay. Normally, when you look at organizations, you are even happy when they do something like traditional protection, taking action after the shit has happened. Today, it's necessary because there are a lot of more threats and their frequency of happening is getting higher and higher. You need not the traditional approach, after the shit happens then take action, but you need what we call a proactive approach. You start by preparing yourself and your organization for before the shit will happen. You have to be aware that the shit always will happen. You don't know exactly when. If it's not today, then it will be tomorrow or next week or next month. And remember, it's not only one time that you get the shit you have to respond to, but there will be several attacks on your organization from several sources, threat agents with several causes. So you need to be aware that when you work in an organization, what's their approach? Traditional? Take action after the shit occurred? Or is it already an organization that has taken a proactive approach, doing a lot in preparation, being ready before, or as ready as possible before the shit happens? So preparation is the fundament of doing incident response. And one of the things is getting your incident response life cycle ready and in order so that everybody knows what to do when it occurs. And there are 6 points that you need when you develop an incident response process. You see them, I won't go deep into the details. Rapid initial assessment. If shit happens, you want to know, what's this? Can we give it a name? The second thing is that you need to have experts on incident response in your organization, and the best way to do it is develop or set up an ERT, incident response team, or a CRT, or whatever name an organization gives to it. a dedicated team that takes the lead when the shit happens. You also need a lot of tools, virtual and real world tools, to take technical action when something bad has occurred. And while you're aware that something shit happened, you must be able as an organization to gather as much as evidence about the attack or the incident as possible. Because sometimes you want to, or you need to, do a deep investigation. And a deep investigation is most of the time a digital forensic investigation that will be part of the guest lecture in 2 weeks, and that will be a complete thematical semester in the next school year. And the people in the room that doing the minor forensic intelligence and security know a lot more about how to do a digital forensic investigation. That's not part of the course incident response, but it's something that I will mention. And one of the main things to have a good response process is document, document, document. I know you students hate to document stuff, but when incidents happen, then it's essential to document not only all the details about the incident, but also all the activities you perform during getting rid of the incident and its causes. And an incident response team is not responsible for the whole business, so you have to be able to tell in lay terms to the management what happened, how did you resolve the problem, and if the organization is safe and secure now. And sometimes big decisions have to be made that is not due to the incident response team, but that's something the management has to do. Okay, when you talk about incident response, it's just, well, a general term. But when you look into practice, you need incident response in an organized way. That every time shit happens, you react in the same standardized way so that you don't forget any step or any activity. If you don't have your incident response in order and shit happens, then it could be disastrous for the organization. It could be either chaotic, or it could even lead to the organization to die, to get out of business. So you need a proper, organized, careful incident response process. Then you have the highest possibility of recovering from the shit. So an ounce of prevention is worth a... Do you know the proverb? An ounce of prevention?
It's worth more than a pound of cure.
Yes. Ounce of prevention, a pound of... Yes. Okay. So a little bit extra time putting into prevention will save you, when things go wrong, a lot of time and money and frustration. So a good response life cycle starts by preparation and ends with full recovery to normal operations. Okay. This picture you already know. This is the standard American way that has been adopted in Europe. The incident response life cycle preparation, that is where it all starts. This is the ounce of prevention. If you don't do it, then detection, containment, and post-incident activity won't go the way you want it to go. The context, to give you the picture, the preparation on the top, you have to perform a risk assessment. That is the course that we had the last quarter. Then you are going to look into what assets do we have, how valuable are they, and what vulnerabilities they have, and how can they be threatened, by whom, and what can we put as countermeasures against these threats. Of course, you have to develop your security architecture. You have to set up your IT infrastructure with a lot of layers of defense. And you have to develop a response plan. So first, thinking about what shit could happen to us as an organization, and what are we going to put into place to prevent as much as possible shit happening. Okay, if your preparation is okay, then still the world is changing. Threat agents have new ways to attack your organization and therefore your assets. And you hope that your preparation has been done in such a way that you get in the right time alerts, warnings, and that can come from different sources. Your employees, or through the help desk, or maybe outside sources have found a new leak and they have published about it, or maybe your suppliers of hardware and software have discovered something and sent you a message that you have to update or patch something. And there can be an outsider or an insider that has been confronted with leakages in your system and gives you some alert or warning that there might be something bad in your systems, and that a threat agent could use that to get in and to get hold of your pieces of gold. So your first stage of the incident response process or life cycle is detect. I will talk about detection in a minute. After you have done, you've got the detection, your alerts and warnings, then you have to filter in first sight what is there happening. You do a triage. Then after the triage, you do the handling of the incident. And at the end, you look back, and most of the time you have some post-incident activities that is normally extra protection, extra countermeasures that could be something like installing extra antivirus or malware detection software, maybe updating or upgrading or even installing firewalls and security zones, so that your organization is divided up into more or less safe zones. You could use or buy or introduce a SIEM, a security incident and event management system. That is a very useful but expensive tool if you want to correlate a lot of data about the events that happened. I'll save that for the lecture in 2 weeks. And of course, if you didn't do it, then monitor, 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 or set up all the logging possibilities on all the pieces of your IT infrastructure that is possible. Okay, that is the context. You know when shit happened. You go into the response part, detection. Then you get your alerts and warning. Identification, also called triage. And then the containment, the eradication, the recovery, and finally the debriefing. And then you can hopefully return to normal business operations. Okay. This was a small recap of the fundamentals on incident response. Now we delve into the incident response in practice. So we talk through all the stages of the incident response lifecycle with the activities you have to perform. And this lifecycle and these activities you should use when solving assignment number 3. Like you saw, the first phase or stage in incident response lifecycle was the preparation. Well, I don't go into details when it's not necessary. The red sentence is vital. Preparation is vital for minimizing the effects of an attack. If you don't do anything about preparation, the attack can destroy all your assets and therefore your organization. Okay. If you look into real life, you should be aware of the preparation practices that are being used and that you should either develop or maintain. Make backup copies on a regular basis on your key data. The problem is that when the shit has happened, sometimes you have to, you can only eradicate and recover from the shit to install a complete backup of all your vital data, and sometimes even a backup of all your systems. When you are not able to backup regularly and save your backups adequately, you could be confronted with the surprise that reading in the backups, reinstalling the backups, gives you a problem. Either the backup is lost, or the backup is not readable, can't be installed, or you forgot to make a backup. And that could be disastrous. A lot of work is then lost. The work has to be redone. In the easiest case, but in the worst case, you're out of systems, you're out of your data, you're out of everything, and therefore you're going out of business. And don't keep your backups in the same location as where your operations are. That's asking for trouble. If a fire starts and your building is in flames, your systems are going down, your backup tapes or whatever medium you use for backing up is also destroyed. So keep it on a safe location. Depending on how you manage your backup, you could also use another form of backing up. You could use a mirror site or whatever. But be aware that you backup and that the backup functions. It's too late to discover that your backup didn't function when the shit has come to you and you have to reinstall and it doesn't do what it should do. That's another open door, monitoring and updating software on a regular basis. The famous Tuesday patches, Wednesday patches, now we have Monday, Thursday, Friday patches. all the time the software wants to be updated, and if you have automatic update on, then it's constantly polling. For example, if you use Windows as an operating system, and about an hour ago my system told me in my room that it needed to update and install a lot of extra applications, and that I only had 540 minutes before the computer would take over. It's boring, but it's necessary. But you can install this updating monitor, updating activity, for example, during specific hours. And only when a very urgent patch is necessary, then you can do an extra update. Monitoring systems. Well, it's like wearing a new smartwatch where your blood pressure, your whatever important health values are measured. It's simply trying, probing in what state you are. That is the same thing you should do with your IT infrastructure. Is the system still breathing? Is it breathing normal? Oop. The system did have a hiccup. Oh, no, it's normal now again. If you monitor, you can see what the system as a kind of organism is doing. There are a lot of monitoring tools. And you not only monitor your IT infrastructure, but specifically you have to monitor all your lines of defenses that you have built up. So there's a lot of monitoring, and most of the times this monitoring leads to logging. So you have log files, quite a lot. And if you ever dig into logging files, it's a very tedious and awesome way to find abnormalities. So you have to be aware that when you use monitoring and write everything into log files, you have to have tooling, an automated agent that will scan the log files for you and only gives you an alert or a warning when something that falls out of the bandwidth is happening. This is where, for example, a security incident and event management system comes in, that is able to read your log files. And it reacts only when it comes across something that is out of the normal. The last thing about the preparation practice is a documented security policy that should be the result of your risk assessment. And if you ask an organization, do you have a security policy? They always say yes, because they have some kind of document that has been named security policy. But if you ask then, do you use the security policy? Huh? Yes, we have a security policy, that should be enough. Yes, but having a document is not enough. Everybody in the organization should be aware of what's in the security policy, what's allowed and what's not allowed, and if something goes wrong, how to react when you have a security incident. So, documenting is okay, but do something with the document, otherwise it's only a paper thing that doesn't work. There are two types of preparation practices, the general ones and the response related ones. I told you about the patch management. You should regularly update But you should have a process in order to do that on a regular basis. Like I told you, you have to build up your lines of defenses, and every perimeter that you have and every zone that you have should be as robust as possible. You should have your antivirus software ready, because malware is one of the main causes that will help systems down. And you should educate everybody in the organization about what kind of shit can happen and how to react when something strange is happening. Okay, when you look into the response part, it's not enough to have an incident response team and an incident response policy. You also have to think about what if the incident response team is looking into an alert or a warning, discovers it's not just an event but it's an incident, and is looking into the type of incident and the consequences that the incident could have, and they come to the conclusion, my God, this is catastrophic. Our whole system could blown to pieces, our organization could go to pieces. Then you have something in place that we call a business continuity plan, a BCP. If your ultimate decision is, my God, this event is really an incident and the incident is a catastrophic one, then the incident response team should be able to start immediately the disaster response. But you have to have ready a business continuity plan and a disaster recovery plan. If not, bye-bye. Well, I talked about policies. That's very nice, that are part of the countermeasures that come out of your risk assessment. Be aware of the people you need when an incident is happening or could happen. Management should know what to do. Management should have arranged the right support. You have an IRT ready, or at least an IR person. It could also be useful to have security advisors. Everybody that is involved in incident response should have the proper training, that they know what to do when disaster strikes. So they have to have exercises, drills. And you need to know if you discover that some criminal activity lies behind the incident, when to call in law enforcement, and who is going to communicate with law enforcement. Not many organizations start, when real shit happens, to contact law enforcement, because they are very afraid for their business reputation. When the police comes in, then you're not happy. They could destroy more than solve your problem. Remember, response, your data. Where do you have everything? And that does not only mean where are the backups and do they do what they have to do. You have to have your crucial documentation at hand, or at least available. It should not be in the same location, but it should be anywhere that you can reach it when a disaster happens. If you use encryption, you must be able to decrypt it when shit happens. And maybe you have software systems, applications that are specially built for you. Hopefully the code of this software is still available when the systems are down. Maybe you made use of key escrow, that could be for the keys of the encrypted communication, but escrow can also be used for specifically for you written software code. Remember, you need a lot of supplies when you have to respond to an incident. You need to have safe and secure laptops with everything installed that you need to look into and investigate the incident. You need to have phones, you need to have backup devices, you need to have things to make notes that can be by hand or electronically or even tape the audio communication. And you need to know who to contact when it happens. So you need, in the field of communications, call lists with the telephone numbers. Who is going to contact whom? In what order? Sometimes if you are an organization that has to comply to laws or specific regulations, you are obliged to notify some government agency. If that's necessary, then you have to know whom to notify. And you need to know, if something happens, where do we build our command center? That could be in the same building, but if there is a fire, you need to have an extra space where you can build up your command center. On the fly, on the spot. So a lot of preparation to be done. And if you don't do this, you can skip it easily, because it only costs time and it costs money, and well, you never know, maybe the shit won't happen to us until the time comes, the moment comes. Then you are very happy that you did a good preparation. Otherwise, you can't start detecting and analyzing the alerts and the warnings that come to you as an IoT. Okay, like I said, you get from a lot of sites, a lot of sources, alerts, warnings. That can be by phone, somebody can tell it to you. It could be by electronic ways, like mail. It could be by traditional mail, if some whistleblower or maybe a supplier gives you information about vulnerabilities in your system. No matter from what source an alert or warning is coming, you have to react. You have to take every alert, every warning serious. You have an initial report, but you have to verify if what's in the report, what the alert or warning says, if that is reliable. Well, you know that people and technology can register if something works normally or shows some kind of, well, odd thing. You don't know exactly what's happening, but you know that there is, might be a problem. What you often see is that when you get an alert or a warning from an end user, most of the times through the help desk, and the help desk will pass it on to the IoT. A user is saying warning you that, for example, specific web pages of your organization are no longer available. I can't log in. Shit! One user got a virus or worm attached to some email or maybe on a USB and let it into the system. For you may be happy with such a user that he is alerting or warning you and not thinking, well, I hope nobody knows and nobody finds out. It can happen to everybody. Maybe your website is going off, or the page of your website is flickering, or there is something with the URL. Users can give a warning that they are retrieving some kind of mail that they might consider to be spam. Somebody is asking for your username and login. Well, it's common policy that only the help desk can do that, and they won't do it the way you got it by mail. Maybe you are an end user and you saw that your colleague was surfing and visiting some suspicious sites. And not only that, you saw some dirty pictures. And there are organizations, specifically American organizations, that force you as an employee to warn, alert, when you see a common worker or a fellow worker do such a thing. It could be that somebody is asking you for private personal information that you normally didn't get. So you must be very happy as a help desk or service desk or an IRT if you get end users that give you alerts or warnings about these things. Okay, that's people. You also have technology. You also can have applications that gives an alert or a warning. For example, if an application behaves strange, or it is continuously closing and you don't know what the problem is. As a user, you can give an alert or a warning, but most of the times, if you set up your systems well, the application should give an alert in the log file or whatever that it's due to some cause behaving abnormally. It could also be that some user tries a specific application that he or she should not use. Then it would be very nice if it's alerted that somebody is trying to use this application. Even worse, not only inappropriate use, but somebody is trying to change your key data, or is trying to redirect your web page. You can install applications in a way that they give you alerts or warnings. It's the same with the system as a whole, so the IT infrastructure. Of course, you have your at least IDS, intrusion detection systems. Maybe you have something more, and you have IPS, an intrusion prevention system. They can monitor if everything is the way it should be, or if something strange is happening, alert. firewall is always logging. If you switched it on, and then in the logs there could be some thing strange. Servers can detect something, either malicious code or an availability. They get an overflow of either communication or other kind of input-output. If you have one main office with a lot of small offices that belong to the organization, it could be a problem when you can't log in to the system from distance. Well, it should be normal to be able to remotely log in. Sometimes somebody is able to change the settings of your systems, your IT infrastructure, without being detected, unless you have software installed, automated watchdogs that monitor if changes that are not allowed are being done. And then of course you have the persons that either virtually or physically break into your IT infrastructure and change something or get something from the servers. So you see a lot of examples where alerts or warnings can come from. So, was the ounce of preparation crucial? Pound is in detection, timely detection. If your building is burned down, okay, then you can detect, yes, we had a fire. The most convenient way is that the moment a spark starts and smoke is the result, you should have been in a situation that some piece of equipment of some person detects that a fire is starting just in time, so that you can begin extinguishing the fire before your building is burned down. So timely detection is crucial. There are a lot of things that can help you by timely detecting. Like I said, the systematic monitoring, alerts, warnings that indicate that an event that might be growing into an incident. Users, system administrators, suppliers can give you a clue. And once in a while you need to have to perform a vulnerability analysis. Are we still plugged in the right way, or are there new vulnerabilities, especially when you updated your IT infrastructure? When you have an alert or warning, and hopefully the alerts and warnings reach you in a timely way, the first thing you have to do is identify the alert or warning to see if it's only, thank God, an event, or that it is not an event, but it's an incident. Therefore, you have to do identification, or what you call triage. Okay, triage. I use the symbol on the right hand side, triage with the cross. Maybe you know the system of triage. If you look into the emergency department of a hospital, then patients come in, either brought by their family or rolled in by an ambulance, and the doctor that is in charge or the nurses that are in charge, the first thing they do is triage. Look at the most vital elements of the patient being brought in and trying to discover ABC, how's the breath, how is the, they have this list they work with, to see how bad it is and how quickly the staff has to react to save this patient. What you see when, for example, a big catastrophe has happened, like a plane crash we had with, for example, the Turkish Airlines with near Schiphol, or a train accident or a big traffic accident, you see the same principle. There are a lot of casualties, and the emergency staff, the medical emergency staff, they do a triage. They have colored cards with letters on it, and they look into a person and they observe their injuries, and then they put on the neck or the wrist of the patient a card with a collar. Red means immediate action. Orange or yellow, it can wait a bit. Green, it can wait some time. And most of the time they have a fourth card, a white card, deceased. So every casualty that comes in the emergency staff area is labeled with the adequate card, and then the surgeons and the nurses are trying to save the patients in order of color. So the red ones are first, then the yellow or orange ones, and then when they don't have any red ones and yellow ones or orange ones over, they start with the green ones. Or if you have a new extra emergency medical personnel coming in and they are not acquainted with this system, you can say, please start treating the green ones. So this same principle, try to figure out how bad it is, this principle of triage out of the emergency or in the medical world, is being used nowadays in some organizations for incident response according to security incident. So the first thing you have to do is it a real threat? Or is it just an event and therefore no incident? You could when you take the similarity with the casualties, has a person injuries? No injuries? Then you're free to go. You don't need a card. You don't need treatment. But if the person you're observing has more than one injury, several injuries, or a very severe injury, then you have to collar the patient. So depending from which source your alert or warning comes, the incident response team has to examine the source, can it be trusted, and what's the content of the alert or the warning. It's very convenient if you look into an alert or a warning that you have more sources that will help you to verify the report you're looking into. So it's nice if you have an end user report, and if you also see in log files that some systems also generated an alert or warning, and that you can correlate them. If the alert warning is okay, then you have to decide only event or incident. Only event, then you could stop. Is it an incident? Then you go on. And sometimes it's very clear that it's not only an event, but it's really an incident if the sprinkler installation is starting to rain. If you do triage on a security event that might be a security incident, you use specific words. The finding, that's the alert or the warning you get. Is there harm to be done caused by the event? Did the event damage something? Is it in the alert warning, is there only a finding, a remark, or is it really an event? And if it's an event, is it an adverse event, a negative, with a negative outcome? If so, then it's possibly a security incident. And if it's an adverse event being a security incident, then you can simply put the stamp on it, yes, this is an incident. It's like a surgeon seeing a new patient at the disaster area. He's taking blood pressure, looking into the eye, trying to discover some breathing, all the vital signs are not observed. Okay, this was an event, this was an incident, patient deceased. If he feels a pulse, if the patient is breathing, he's not quite reacting when you're looking him into the eyes, you could tap, hey, he's reacting. A lot of blood over there, his arm is in a bad position. Okay. Can it wait? Yes, he's breathing. Okay, let's give him a green card. So you need to know, do we have to act? We act only when it's a real incident. Okay. You know, when it's not only an event, but surely it's an incident, you have to look into the root cause that can cause loss of your CIA. I'm not going to talk you through all the root causes. You've seen them. They're listed here. A, human error, until E, third party, external party failures. So the only thing you have to do is, what's the root cause? The next thing you have to do is, okay, we have an incident. We know from which source it came, the root cause. What's the impact? And then we have to look into three things. What's the functional impact? Our business has to do what it's got to do, because we have a mission and we have business processes running. Is the incident we are investigating or identifying impacted by this incident in a way that our business cannot function the way it should. Then we have to look into the information impact. How about the CIA of our data? And third, we have to look in, is it possible that we can recover from this incident and return to normal operations? And then we have to take into account how much time and how many resources do we need to recover. How do you do that? You can simply use the traffic light model again. The biggest functional impact gets the highest ranking. So the impact of a specific incident can be either high, medium, low, or none. If you only want to use, instead of four categories, three categories, then you have high, the orange medium, and the green low, and the white none. So it's depending on what your organization decides for coloring system. If it's low, medium, or high, then you have a functional impact of the incident that is happening. Then the informational impact goes the same way. Four categories: red, orange, yellow, green, or if you only have three, then it would be red, orange, green, and the green is then white. None could be white. So integrity loss is the highest possible impact on the information side, and the loss of CIA. Recoverability is the last impact category you have to look into. You don't hope you have to label not recoverable, because then you're out of business. It can be the same way, regular, supplemented, extended, four colors. But there is an extra opportunity. The American way is that you have to look into the classification levels of your data, and you have to classify all your data, and your data is either top secret, or secret, or official, or unclassified personal, or unclassified. If it's unclassified, everybody can look into that data. If it's top secret, well, actually nobody, only the president can look into the data. Depending on the data classification category, you can also put an impact level on that data with the business impact, and you see it's the same setup. Red is high, orange is medium, and if you use the yellow, then orange is real high, and so on and so on. This is a very nice coloring system that you could use for all these categories for deciding what's the impact of the incident. Management that has no big understanding of IT or security incidents can understand this traffic light model. If everything is red, then it's bad. So after you decided what's the impact, you have to decide what's the severity. How severe could it be? Well, it, depending on what is impacted by the threat or the incident, it's low, medium, high. You can also use a 5-level, it's the same way that you saw in the other scheme. So at the end of the detection, you could say the identification triage situation, you've handled these activities or these actions. First, determine whether an incident has occurred, then classifying it, and after you know the root cause and the classification, you hope you have a standard checklist what to do next, how to handle the specific incident when you have finished this line. This is a simple example from an initial incident handling checklist based on the 4 known categories: unauthorized usage, inappropriate usage, malicious code, and denial of service. And then you have to have a checklist ready that if one of the 4 types has been discovered as being the root cause of the incident, then it's simple. You simply use the incident handling checklist, for example, for denial of service, or the incident handling checklist for malicious code. If it the root cause is not clear, then you have to do something else. Am I going to do this? No, I'm not going to do this. We are going to have a break. 3 o'clock, we'll start again. Okay, 3 o'clock. We don't miss anything about the weather because it's raining outside. So, even if you like to sit on a sunny terrace with a cool drink, well, the weather is making it impossible. So you have to delay that until a later day in this week, hopefully. We just ended by the first part. We have determined whether an incident has occurred. So it's not an event, but it's a real incident. And then we have tried to classify the incident into one of the 4 root causes. And if it's one of the 4 root causes or a combination, then we could use the according checklist for incident handling for the moment. And if it doesn't fit in one of the 4 root causes, then we have to use and to follow the a general checklist. Remember portion 1.4, as soon as the handler believes an incident has occurred, begin documenting the investigation and start gathering evidence. Okay. If you start documenting and gathering evidence, there are 2 main questions: the what and the how. What attack occurred and how did this attack occur? There are several questions that can help you find answers on the what and the how. So it's very convenient to think and use your critical mind to find the answers. Everything that comes across about the attack, the incident, the what and the how, you should document, and most of the times you have a specific system or application for handling incidents. This is an example of a screenshot. And this is when you look at the top, every incident gets a number, a status, a type, where it comes from, and whatever. Maybe somebody who reported it with his or her information, and then you can get some technical stuff documented about the internal machine. And on the next sheet, you see the same, but then with the information on maybe external machine from which the attack came. So you can start documenting this. It will help you later on not only to generate your incident report, but also when you have to do a follow-up, a deep going incident investigation. It's very useful if you can fall back on this documented stuff. So, at the end of the analysis stage, we have categorized, we have prioritized, depending on the impact, the severity, and so on, and we have to assign staff who's going to tackle this incident. It could be looking into the duty schedule, who's working and who's free, and you could look into who's the most competent person in the IRT to deal with this type of incident. I don't want to talk about correlation now, because I will take that into account when we talk about the SIEM application. Example. For example, the US CERT has the same type of categories, 1, 2, 3, 4, between quotes. And this is category 1, 2, 3, 4. And you see a category 0, for example, when you are doing pen testing. And here are some extra categories. Here is a description, and this is when between the incident happening, the alert warning, should you notify or react. So this is a handy example of checklists that can be used, but remember, a checklist is only a means, it's not something that you have to follow on the letter, just by mind. After the detection and analysis stage, we come in the third life cycle stage, the containment, eradication and recovery. Stop spreading the incident, and eventually, after repairing what you can repair, return to normal operations. So the first thing to do when you know this type of incident with this impact and this severity is at hand, stop the incident from contaminating your organization. It's like a patient with an infectious disease. You put them apart, like somebody who got Ebola. They put them apart in a very clean, isolated room, so you can't get contamination from this Ebola patient to other personnel or other patients. That is what you do when you are trying to contain the breach or the incident. Try to isolate it so that it can't spread. Okay. if you notice a fire, a beginning fire, immediately start the fire alarm and get your fire extinguisher to tackle the fire. Then you have contained it. But then you have to think, when you are doing containment, of course you try to limit the impact of the breach as far as possible, but in the meantime you have to preserve the evidence, either for later investigation or maybe for insurance matters or for legal obligations. And you have to control the awareness about the breach. You have to prevent that everybody gets aware that shit is happening or has happened, especially the outside world. Okay, when you are limiting the impact of the breach, there are three parties that become active. Of course, the IRT, the incident response team. They are technically trying to collect the data, the evidence, analyzing log files. If experts are necessary, they get experts in, and they try to work their way around the location of the breach. Management should be informed, because sometimes bad decisions need to be made, and that's not part of the IRT, that's management. And they need to notify official agencies, whatever. They have to approve if you need to escalate to higher levels or to alarm the fire brigade if you can't extinguish the fire. And you have to be aware that you have to inform the legal department, because liability and getting sued or fined is nearby when you are experiencing a breach. And the main thing you are trying to do is isolating the problem, like isolating the Ebola patient. It depends on the root cause, what you have to do. Sometimes you have to take all the systems down, if possible. Or you have to plug temporarily some holes to prevent the attacker to get in again. And remember, all the time, obtain, preserve evidence for investigation. Why is this so necessary? Sometimes, or most of the times, you are accounted for how you tackle an incident. And if you can't prove what actions you undertook, and if you can't prove you did your ultimate best to limit the impact, then you could be liable. And that's why you start, it could be a spreadsheet, an evidence identification log. All the items that you saved, that you obtained, that you preserved, are being noted into the identification log, and everybody that handles the evidence should be noted also in the evidence log. That's because you need to have what we call a chain of custody or chain of evidence. Every piece of evidence should be accounted for, who's putting the copy or the real evidence into the log, where has it been stored, located, who has been looking into the evidence, whatever. It's a chain, so you can't afford to have a break of the chain. Therefore, you need this evidence log. But that is something that we'll talk about next lecture. And our guest speaker is a person who did quite a lot of this work. And the forensic intelligence students should have encountered all this stuff on preserving the evidence, collecting the evidence, analyzing the evidence. Controlling awareness of the breach, yes. If something odd happens, there's a great possibility that panic is starting. So you have to try to get the people at ease. That's not easy, because if fire alarm starts, then everybody has and everybody is looking at each other. Is it an exercise, a drill, or is it real? Do we have to leave the building, or can we just sit and work? Well, it depends. If you're on the 10th floor and the elevators aren't working because of the fire alarm, maybe it's useful to take all the stairs down while it's still convenient. Well, panic is always a possibility, specifically if you have to evacuate people out of rooms or out of the building. And you have to maintain confidentiality. If something bad happens, people tend to open doors, leave doors open, and that is a possibility for others that have maybe a bad attitude to make use of the situation that's available. Remember about the physical black bag job that you had to perform. Some teams started the fire alarm because they knew that they could get hold of confidential data. So you not only have to concern yourself with the breach, but also with the people. Save the persons first, safety first, then security, remember. Okay, after containment, so the isolation of the troublesome part, you have to eradicate. Try to find a solution for the problem that has occurred. That could be a temporary solution, most of the times. And then after you have the incident under control, you can start working on a definitive solution. Also, during eradication, after the containment, you have to investigate what temporary countermeasures could be the most convenient in the situation at hand. It could be a temporary fix. And sometimes you don't have any alternative than simply pull the plug. Shut the complete system down. But that's not a decision of the IRT. That's a decision the management should make after being advised by the incident response team. Because no system, no business. No business, no money. Okay, eradication, simply fix the problem as soon as possible and when necessary, quick and dirty, but you always have to have a plan B, that if the temporarily fixed doesn't work, you have to have an extra set of measures ready. And in the case of a big catastrophe, your backout plan should be your disaster recovery plan. If you do the things right, you have documented, and this is an example of a form that you could use, incident type, the one who did this, or from whom the alert warning came from, what you did on triage, what escalation conditions and steps are suggested, then how to contain and eradicate, and some specific notes for after the incident is handled. So this could be simply a form that you could use. Just an example. Put it all together, eradication. After determined causes and symptoms, you have to improve your defenses. You have to perform a vulnerability analysis. Where are the clean backups? Do we have them? Then eliminate the root cause. And finally, you have to, if you have to take serious measures, you have to discuss it with management. And finally, hopefully soon, you could do recovery, or better said, return to normal operative secure status. After the system is on and clean, you're not in business, because you have to not only reinstall backups, but you also have to supplementary do all the additional patching that and updating that came across after you did your last backup. When everything is installed, you have to test it. You have to validate if the system is good, is up and running in a clean and clear way. Sometimes it's an obligation to get it signed off, to have an official signature. Only when it's fully tested and operational, you can give the signal clear, shit is over. And from that moment on, you start monitoring, regular monitoring your system and waiting for the next alert or warning coming in. Whoo, the system is running again. And then you can get some read and set up your mind to, okay, what damage is there being done? What has been lost? And after recovery, what's the status of the system? Are we sure that everything works the way it should work? The aftermath. If you don't know one of the four root causes, or you do, the next step in this sample of a checklist is containment, eradication and recovery. You see point three, acquire, preserve, secure and document evidence. Contain the incident, eradicate the incident, identify it and plug the holes, remove, recover, and then you go to the last stage, the post-incident activity. Remember, this is only a simple example of a checklist. Don't be, if you have to do jobs like this or work like this, use this as the Holy Bible. It's only an instrument that can guide you through a lot of activities. And the activities that stand in these types of checklists are in a good order, but it doesn't say that you can put your critical mind in the fridge. Don't stop thinking yourself. Don't be a fool with a lot of checklists and simply follow the checklist, then everything will be okay. Post-incident activities, the final stage phase in our life cycle. Lessons learned, that's the word that fits the most convenient way this stage. Okay, follow up. Now it could be time, because all the chaos and all the rumor is gone, to do a deep investigation. For example, a digital forensic investigation. First, we had to be aware of what is happening. How could it happen? Now you can start thinking about why could it happen? That's a big question. The what and how are simple questions. The why is looking for deeper causes. Because the system is clean, is up and running again, you can look back and try to find out if you, as an incident response team, handled the incident properly and in time, promptly. And maybe there are points in the process that you undertook that could be better. So you get to the lessons learned. You look back into the past. You do it today, and you hope to find useful information for the rest of this day and for tomorrow. So it's like history investigation. Okay. You start most of the times in the post-incident activity with a debrief or a debriefing. Everybody that was involved solving the incident should be together and try to answer the questions that are bulleted on this slide. With the answers and with the experience you have and the documentation you produced, it could be very useful to make a kind of exercise or training out of this specific incident that you just had at hand, so that new employees could learn that if something like that happens, what the impact, the severity, and so on, is, and how the best way to handle a certain type of incident. That is where you often see in organizations that they do tabletop exercises, dry incident response, or they have classes or trainings, sessions, capture the flag. Capture the flag reminds me of if you still want to go to Croatia at the beginning of July for this international week, you should be very quick if you want to enlist. There are, I think, 5 or 7 places for Dutch students. Okay. Haha, closure. Closure of the incident. Or close out. Now the incident response team writes its official report. What happened? How did it happen? Was there something lost or stolen? Lessons learned in the way. How can we prevent this? And what can we as IoT do better? any documentation about the incident response and the incident handling should be kept for record keeping, so that not only you have your official version of what occurred to prove if you have to, but also if you want to analyze over time the performance of an organization, of how many incidents of what type you have. You can make statistical information out of this. It's useful to have an archive where your records about incident handling and incident response are being kept for. So this means that your life cycle comes to an end. But because you learned some lessons, it could mean that you have to adjust your preparation, add extra countermeasures, update whatever procedures or checklists, and then it's waiting for the next shit to happen. That's always somewhere between the preparation and here is the point where the next shit will happen. Assignment number 3 takes you all the way through the incident response activity. I will brief you on it. I'll have to look, yes. And I will need, Bart again, because you have an automatic random number generator. Yes, could you? We need it. Okay. Because, like I said at the beginning of the lecture, next Monday, we're closed. So I'll give you assignment number 3, and you have the time until next Friday, the 29th, 33.59 hours. So you have almost 2 weeks to perform this assignment. And then Monday in 2 weeks, you get the last and final assignment. Okay. You need to have, next to what you are used to, overt sources and your critical minds in the team, a special NIST guide, the National Institute of Security and Technology. I will show it what it is, and I will upload it on the VLO. Okay. You could use the same organization and as that has been part of the assignment number 1 and 2, this sales company, so you don't have to invent an organization. The third job, assignment 3, you have to build incident response skills, and you have to identify potential issues with incident response processes. Your team is an IRT, so an incident response team. Each team is presented with a scenario and a list of questions related to that scenario. Each question you should discuss, and you should determine and write down, of course, the most likely answer per question. The results should be that what your team would really do, and compare it with policies, procedures, and generally recommended practices to identify any discrepancies or deficiencies, blah, 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 blah. We have 16 teams, so I have 16 scenarios, and with the help of Bart, I will make a correlation between each team and a specific scenario. But nevertheless, which scenario you will get as a team, there is a set of general questions that will be should be answered by every and each team. It can be that per scenario there are some extra questions. Okay. I will show you. These are questions: preparation, detection and analysis, containment, a post-incident activity. I'll take one. If you see this question, this is a general question to be answered per team, and in brackets you see at the end section 2.1. That refers to the NIST guide. The NIST Computer Security Incident Handling Guide document. And that's the code of the document and the name of the document. I will upload it to the VLO, so you don't have to invent your wheel, but you have to try to use a very much common used wheel in the world of incident response and incident handling. So, remember, would the organization consider this activity to be an incident? When there's deorganization, then bear in mind the organization that you already probed in assignment 1 and 2, this sales division company. I don't know what the answer is, that's for you to find out, but what criteria you should use, you can find it in section 2.1 of the NIST guide. And the next question, you can get help from section 3.1.2 in the NIST guide, and so on, and so on, and so on, and so on. So, that's the brief. Next to the brief, every team gets a specific scenario. I have 16 scenarios. And it's possible that at the end of your scenario there are some additional questions that only belongs to this specific scenario. If you look at scenario 1, here you have scenario 2. So you have your general questions and you have your scenario specific. And this is the NIST guide. Yes, come on. So don't read the total guide unless you are like to read, but most of the students don't like to read. So you can look into the table of contents. You see here the chapters and the paragraphs, and you simply, if a question refers to a specific section, go, for example, if you need to have 2.1, click on it, and then you are at the right spot in the complete guide. So your assignment is, for each of the 16 teams, how to respond to a specific incident. That's your scenario. The material you get, of course, the lecture slides, specifically the lecture slides of today. You get your brief, you get your scenarios, and you get your NIST guide. These are the four types of input. What you have to do is answer all the questions, and you have to visualize your incident response. Results, remember, only a Word document and a PowerPoint document. No zips, no RAS. Two separate documents. The Word document is the question plus your team answer all the way down. And you make a PowerPoint with a visualization how you as a IRT respond to the incident scenario. Now we are going, I put the team number, and next to the team number comes the scenario number. But if you could randomly generate a number between 1 and 16.
4.
So scenario 4 is for team number 1. Team number 2. 14? 14. Team 3. Team 4.
12.
Team 5.
9.
Team 6.
8.
Team 7.
6.
8.
16.
9.
15.
10.
11.
Team 11.
13.
Team 12.
10.
Oops. Team 13.
1.
Team 14.
That's 2.
Team 15.
5.
And last but not least, team 16.
Seven.
Let's check if we are complete. Scenario 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. 14, 15, 16. Bingo! So I'll put an extra slide into this set with the numbers of the teams and the scenarios. And then you could start. Remember, you have until next Friday. So you have two options. Don't. Please, 1 more minute. I'm looking towards the back of some person. Okay. Upcoming Thursday, 2 o'clock, you have sent in your liaison officer into room 3.46 for putting questions forward, and it's the same Thursday a week later, so you have 2 opportunities to put your questions forward and to get extra instructions from the zero team. Remember to send in your liaison officer, and if the liaison officer is not available, then you send in a backup 2 o'clock. There should be, after this lecture, for the security students, the possibility to look into the exam of risk assessment, but there are a lot of people that